the adjournment prorogation. Or prorogue, and dissolution. In fact, in common parlance, adjournment and dissolution is more commonly heard, and prorogation is something which is heard by only people, mostly people who are following the proceedings closely, or people like us who are in the system and who have seen it. To start with adjournment, adjournment only defers the deliberations. It doesn't terminate the session. There is a session which has a starting date. Session will have a start date and an end date. An end. This is a session. While this session is on, there can be number of adjournments during this period. So what they are doing, they are only deferring the discussion to be held on that day to the next hour or to the next day, based on various things you might be seeing on in the news also. So, but it has no impact on the pending bills, pending notices. On these things it has no impact. There is no legal impact on that. It has impact as far as the quality is concerned. The delay may happen, but as far as the legality is concerned, they sustain, they are still live, they do not lapse. And the power to adjourn is not exercised by the president or the governor. The power to adjourn is exercised by the chairman of the Speaker of the House. And that is about the adjournment. As far as prorogation and dissolution is concerned, if I divide between state system and the union, in union under Article 85 of Constitution of India, and Article 174 of the Constitution of India. These two subjects are dealt by these two articles. The power to prorogue and to dissolve the House or the state legislature lies with President in case of Union. President in case of Union. And governor in case of state. And this power is to be exercised, it goes without saying that it has to be exercised with the advice of Council of Ministers. It is not the discretionary power of the head of the state or head of the country. It is not the discretionary power, it is the power which is to be exercised on the advice of the Council of Ministers. Now, prorogation terminates this session. As I said, adjournment has a start date and end date. So prorogation will terminate a session. Session starts when it is summoned. The session is called under Article 85 by the President, under Article 174 by the Governor. The session starts. But the session has to end. And when the session ends, we say it is prorogued. So it terminates the session. And what is the impact of prorogation, termination of the session on the bills which are pending? The bills which are pending do not lapse. There is no legal impact on that. They may be deferred, but it doesn't lapse, unlike the British practice. But the notices which are pending do lapse. The bills, the prorogation doesn't have any impact, no impact on bills, no impact. It has no impact, but it has impact on the notices. Impact is there on the notices. Notices. Now, the dissolution. Again, as I said, it is the power which is with the President or the Governor. and dissolution is automatic when the term ends, when the life of the Lok Sabha or life by the virtue of 5 years for state and union, but in case of union there is a difference, it can be extended during emergency, and when that extended period lapses, then the dissolution happens automatically. Otherwise, if there is no extension, dissolution happens automatically. Now, what are the other impacts of dissolution? Dissolution will have impact on bills. If we say bills which are pending with Rajya Sabha, bills which are pending with Rajya Sabha and not passed by Lok Sabha, not have been through Lok Sabha. They will not lapse. This is there under Article 107 for the Union and 196 for the States. Article 107 for the Union and Article 196 for the States. This is Union and States. In fact, there is one very interesting thing. If you add 89 number to the provisions which are there for the Union, you get the corresponding provision for the state. Not for all the articles, but for majority of the articles, try to do that. You add 89 to the article of the union, you get the corresponding article of the state government. And here is the example. I can cite number of them. Anyway, now this is there under Article 107 for the Union and 196 for the states, that it doesn't lapse if it is pending with Rajya Sabha but it has not been passed by Lok Sabha. But if it is pending with Lok Sabha, it lapses. If it is pending with Rajya Sabha and has been passed by Lok Sabha, that also lapses. So those which are pending with Lok Sabha, they lapse. Those which are pending with Rajya Sabha and have been passed by Lok Sabha, they lapse. And those which are pending with Rajya Sabha and not been passed by Lok Sabha, they do not lapse. And the bills for which the joint session has been notice for the joint session under Article 108. So this provision of lapsing, it is mentioned in the Article 107. It is not applicable in case of the state government, but there is no joint sitting. In case of union, there is a joint sitting, provision for joint sitting when there is a deadlock in passing of the bill other than money bill, there is a provision for a joint session. We'll have a separate session on the joint session. And if the notification has been issued under Article 108 by the President, notice has been issued, not the notification, intention of holding a joint session, then also it doesn't lapse. So these are the provisions which are mentioned in Article 107 regarding lapsing of the bills. So that's all for the three areas which I wanted to cover in this lecture. I'll be having more lectures on other provisions. Grateful for watching this. Thank you.